Hello everyone, today in this video we will be solving the first question of the fourth topic, which is functions. So in this question we have been asked to define two methods to print the maximum and the minimum number among the three numbers entered by the user. Okay, so what is the thing is that user will enter three numbers. So let's suppose the numbers are A, which is 5, and B, which is 7, and C, which is 3. Okay, so we got the three numbers from the user. Our task is to define two functions. Okay, let's define two functions in which we'll be returning the maximum and the minimum value. Okay, so how to find out the maximum among this one and the minimum among this one? Okay, how to find out the maximum and the minimum among these two numbers? Okay, so what we'll be doing is we'll be keeping a variable called max to find out the maximum number, and that will be initially 0. Okay, then what we'll be doing is we'll be comparing that with each of the digits. Okay, what I mean is max will be compared with A. Okay, is max greater or A is greater? A is greater, right? So the max will become 5. Okay, so the value of max will become 5. Then in the next iteration, what we'll be doing is we'll be comparing 5 with 7. Which is greater, 5 or 7? 7 is greater, right? So max value will be updated to 7. Okay, and then finally we have the 3. 3 will be compared with 7, which is greater. 7 is greater, so we'll keep 7 as such. Okay, so we got the maximum value. In the same way, we'll find out the minimum value. So for minimum value, what we'll be doing is we'll be keeping a min variable here that will be initially like a 999. Okay, so and after that, what we'll be doing is we'll be comparing 999 with each of the digits, like 5 with 999, which is lesser. 5 is less or 999? 5 is less, right? So we'll be updating the minimum value with 5. Whichever is lesser, we'll be updating that value. Next, we'll be comparing 5 with 7, which is lesser, 5. So we'll keep it as such. Then we'll be comparing 3 with 5, which is lesser, 3. Therefore, we'll update minimum value with 3. Okay, so here the minimum value will become 3. And whenever we get a maximum and minimum value after the final iteration, we'll be returning the maximum and the minimum value. Okay, so let's write the code for it. First, I will be taking 3 numbers here. That's the first step. Create the 3 integer variables and take the values, and then call two functions, max and minimum, okay, which will find out the maximum and the minimum value. Okay, so let's move to the code part now. So here I've defined three variables in ABC, and we have the scanner object here, SC, using which we'll take the three inputs ABC, and after that we'll be calling two functions, FN max, and we'll be passing three variables A, B, and C, A, comma B, comma C. Okay, so in the same way, we'll be calling the function FN underscore minimum to find out the minimum value. It will be A, B, and C, and the values returned by these functions will be stored in min value. Okay, min value will store this one, and this will be stored by in max value. Okay, in the same way, we have to initialize the minimum value also. So let's make it in minimum value, and we'll define the functions now. Okay, defining the function is also very easy. So first, we'll copy this syntax here, and we'll paste it here, and we'll just edit the name as we have written here, fn max. So the first name will be fn max. Let's write here, and the function and the parameters accepted by the function are int a, comma int b, comma int c. Right. Then what we'll be doing is we'll be creating a variable int max, which will be equal to 0, and then we'll be comparing three conditions. If a is greater than max, then what should be the max value? A. Then we'll be comparing is b greater than max. Okay, if b is greater than max, okay, if b is greater than max, max will be b. Okay, and then finally, if c is greater than max, then what will be the case? Max is equal to c. Okay, and then finally we'll return c, return max. Okay, and same thing will be done for the minimum function as well. So here we have the minimum function, f min. So instead of greater than, we will be writing here minimum, less than, and here also less than, so that it returns the value, and this will be stored in these both values. Let's print out the values then. So I'll be writing here the maximum number is, then I'll be outputting the max value. Okay, and then what I have is slash in the minimum value, and then I will be outputting the minimum value. Okay, let's try to run this program and see. You have to enter 3 digits here. So let's enter 5, 7 and 3. Maximum should be 7 and minimum should be 3. Okay, so maximum number is 7, minimum number is 3 is showing, so it's the correct answer. So let's move to the next question now. The next program is to define a program to find out whether a given number is even or odd. Okay, you have to just write the function, so let's do that here. So we'll be having the same things here. Okay. And here we'll be taking the number, so we'll be having just n in which we'll be storing the number. Okay, we'll be taking the number input and we'll be calling the function even or odd. Okay, this is the function and we'll be passing n. Okay, so this function will print if it even or odd. So let's write here public static void even or odd, and here we'll be taking the argument n, and we'll be checking if n percentage 2 equal to 0, that means it's even, so we'll print out even, else we'll print out odd. Okay, else okay, if it's even it will print out even, else it will print out odd. Okay, so let's erase this one here and let's try to run this program. You have to enter a number here. Okay, let's enter a number like 2, it's even, and let's try for odd number. Odd number is 5, so it's showing odd. Okay, so let's move on to the next one. Our next program is to write a function to find out if a person is eligible to vote if his or her age is greater than or equal to 18. So let's write the program here. It will be same as this one, and here we'll have eligible. So let's write the function name as eligible. Okay, and we'll be passing n. N will be the age of the person, and if that if n is greater than or equal to 18, then eligible. It will show as eligible. Okay. Else it will show as not eligible. Okay. Let's try to run this program. And here I have to enter the age. If I enter like 13, it's showing not eligible. If I enter like 19, it's showing eligible. Okay. So let's move to the next one. The next question is to write a program to print the sum of two numbers entered by the user, defining your own method. Okay, so what we have to do is we have to take two numbers from the user. So let's call it n1 and n2, and we'll be taking the numbers in n1 and n2. So let's write it here. After taking the numbers, we have to call the function by passing two numbers. So we'll pass here n1 comma n2, and here we'll define the function's name as sum. And here we'll have the sum function, and here we'll accept two integers n1 and n2. And what we'll be doing is we'll be printing n1 plus n2. Okay, so let's try to run this program. And here, if I enter the two numbers as 1 and 3, it's showing 4. Okay. Let's move to the next one, which is to define a method that returns the product of two numbers entered by the user. Okay, so it returns the product, it returns, so we have to write here int, and we have to type here returns n1 plus n2. Okay, so it will return n1 into n2, and here we will change the name. So I don't feel it's necessary to change the name, you got the point, right? So we'll write here int prod, which will store the product, and then we'll be displaying the product. Okay, here we'll be showing the product is, and then we'll be outputting product. Okay, let's try to run this program. So I'll be entering 4 and 5, it's giving me 20. Okay, let's move on to the next one, which is to write a program to print the circumference and the area of the circle of the radius entered by the user by defining your own method. Okay, let's create a function here. What you have to do, if it prints the circumference, so we need not return any value, so we can create it as void, and here we can circumference and area. Okay, And we'll be taking the radius, so we'll be having int r, and here we'll be having r, in which we'll be taking the radius from the user, and we can have double or float here, but for now let's focus on the function. R is taken. Now what we have to do is we have to call the function, which is circle and area. So let's call this function from the main function, and here we'll be passing r. Okay, when r is passed, what should happen is it should print the circumference and the area of the circle. What is the circumference of the circle? Write the circumference is 2 pi r, so we'll be writing 2 into 3.14 into r. Okay, r is passed by the user, and then we'll be printing out the area. So area is pi r square, so we'll be writing 3.14 into r into r. Okay, so let's try to run this program and see if it works. Here we have to enter the radius. Okay, let's enter 5, so it's showing me the circumference as well as the area. Okay, let's move on to the next one, which is to define a method to print if to find out if a number is prime or not. Okay, to see if a number is prime or not, what we have to do is let's discuss here. Suppose that the number is, let's take the number 21. If to check if the number is divisible by if it's a prime or not, what we have to do is we have to start from 1 and go till 21, and in each time you have to check if it's divisible by any of the digits in between these. Okay, like 21 modulus 1, not 1, sorry, not 1 will be starting from 2. Okay, if it's modulus 2 equal to 0, means it's divisible or not, then 3, then 4, then 5, then 6, like that will go on till 21. If any of the cases, if it's divisible, that means it's not a prime, because prime number will not be divisible by any number except the number or 1. Okay, so if it's divisible at any of the case, a number in between 2 and 21, so it is not a prime number. So that check we'll be making. For that we'll be using a for loop. So let's write the code for it. Firstly we'll be taking the number. Okay, here we'll have the number, and we'll be checking if it's a prime or not. So let's define the function prime or not, and here we'll be having prime or not. Okay, and inside that we'll be accepting the number, which is n. Okay, so after this what we have to do is we have to run a for loop from 2 to that number. For int I is equal to 2, I is less than or equal to n, I plus plus. Okay, and we'll have a flag also. Okay, means boolean flag. Okay, that will be equal to false. Okay, and that will be true. Okay, and whenever we get if n modulus I, okay, n modulus I equal to 0, at that time flag should become false. Okay, in that way we can finally test if the value of flag is true or not. If flag is true, that means it's a prime. Okay, because it has not reached false, because that indicates that any of the number in which I was there, means from 2 to n, it was not divisible, and due to that line did not execute, and therefore it remained true. That means it's a prime number. If flag means if flag is true, system.out.println prime. Okay, else not prime. Okay, let's try to run this program. Here we have to enter a number. Okay, let's enter 4. It's showing not prime. Let's enter a prime number, which is 29. So let's enter 29 and see. It's not prime. Okay, 29 is actually a prime number, so we have to write here less than n. Okay, because if it's equal to n, obviously it will be divisible by the same number. So let's try to run this now and enter 29. It's showing prime number. Okay, let's move on to the next one, which is write a program that will ask the user to enter the student's marks out of 100 and define a method that will display the grades according to the marks. Okay, so if it's between 91 and 100, it will show AA, else it will show AB. If it's between 81 and 90, else the following conditions will apply. Okay, so let's first write a program to take the user's marks. Okay, so if the marks is n, okay, So let's suppose that the marks is n. We are taking the user's marks here, and then we'll be calling the function calculate grade. This is the function calculate grade. Let's write it here, and we'll get the value here. Okay, the marks will be in n. Okay, then what we'll be doing is we'll be performing the if else. Statements. Okay, so here we'll be checking if n is greater than or equal to 91 and n is less than or equal to 100. That means it's lying between 91 and 100. Okay, at that time what we'll be doing is we'll be creating a char here, char grade, and inside the char grade we'll be storing the grade. Okay, so grade will be equal to, what should be the grade if it's it should be AA. Okay, if it's between 91 and 100. Else, if, so we can't store two digits in a grade. Let's suppose that it's a string. Okay, let's take it as a string. S capital, and what we have is a string here. Okay, else if n is greater than or equal to 81 and n is less than or equal to 90. Okay, if this is the case, what should be the grade? Grade is equal to AB. Okay, in the same way we will define for all the possibilities. So I have written all the possible grades which the user can get, and then what we'll be doing is after this function gets over, we'll be printing the grade. Okay, so let's print the grade of the person. So here we'll be printing grade. Okay, so let's try to run this program and enter the user's marks. So here we have to enter the user's grade. If I enter 55, it's showing CD. Let's check with the question. If it's 55, it should lie between 51 and 60, which is CD. Okay, now let's try to enter less than 40. So let's enter like 39. Okay, if I enter here 39, the answer would be fail, so it's showing the correct answer. Okay, let's move on to the next one, which is to write a program to print the factorial of a number by defining a method factorial. Okay, you have to take in the number and print its factorial. Okay, so let's write the program for it. So here we'll have fact, which will take a number. So let's write it as fact, and which will be taking a number, and how to calculate the factorial. Okay, factorial of let's discuss here. Factorial of a number means, suppose that the number is 3. Okay, what will be 3 factorial? 3 into 2 into 1. Okay, so for that we can use a for loop. If it's 1, it should output like 1 only, else it should be multiplied with 2, and which is less than 3. Okay, means first it should multiply 3 and then multiply with 2, which will be stored in the same variable. Okay, so let's write the code for it. Here we will be calling the fact. Okay, and first we have the two conditions. Okay, so let's return the factorial. Okay, int, and here we have we'll be storing the result. So here we'll have factorial is equal to fact of n. Okay, so here the result will be stored, and this will be in factorial. Okay, then we'll be printing out the value of factorial. Okay, so let's see how to write the factorial function. So if n equal to 0, at that time return 1. Okay, else if n equal to 1, then return 1. Okay, else what we can do is we can have a for loop here. For int I is equal to 2, I is less than or equal to n, I plus plus. Okay, so each time what we'll be doing is we'll be having a int prod, which will be storing the final product, which will be initialized as 1, and then what we'll be doing is each time we'll be multiplying prod into is equal to I. Okay, so what will happen is when I is 2, product will be multiplied with 2 and it will be stored in product. Okay, and then I will become 3, then 3 will be multiplied, I will become 4, 4 will be multiplied till n. Okay,
n is what we want, right? So n will be multiplied, till n it will be multiplied, and that will be stored in product, okay? And finally we'll be returning the product after this function is over, okay? Return product. Let's try to run this program and see if it works. So here if I enter a value here like 5, it should show me 120. So it's showing the factorial of 5. And let's move on to the next one. Our next question is to write a function to find if a number is palindrome or not. Okay, take the number as the parameter. Let's try a different approach to this question. We have solved this question in the previous one. Let's try a different approach. To check if a number is palindrome or not, let's consider an example like 1, 5, 5, 2, 5, 5, 1. Okay. Or let's edit here like 4. Okay. So this is the number which is given to us. We have to check if it's a palindrome or not. What we'll be doing is to check if it's a palindrome or not, we'll be taking the last digit here. Okay. That we'll be writing in the first position. Okay. And then we'll be taking the second last digit and writing in the second position. Okay. Then in the same way we'll do for the rest of the digits also. So what answer we'll get is 5, 2, 5, 4, 1. After we get this answer, we'll compare with this answer. If both the answers are same, then what we'll say, it's a palindrome. Else it's not a palindrome. Now the question is, how we'll take the last digit and enter in the first position, second last digit in the second position, how we can obtain that? First, what we'll be doing is, we'll be making a copy of the number here, okay? So this number will be copied in another integer variable, which is like n1 or n2. So there we'll have the same number, okay? There we'll have the same number. Then what we'll be doing is, we'll be doing modulus 10 to get the last digit. What in the first step, what we'll do? Modulus 10, okay? When we do modulus 10, what we answer we'll get is 1, okay? So 1 will be stored at a location, okay? In one variable, 1 will be stored. In the next iteration also, but before going on to the next iteration, what I will do is, I will do divide is equal to 10, okay? Means if I divide by 10, okay, before going on to the next iteration, I will divide this by 10. So if I divide by 10, what answer I will get is, this will be removed, right? This will be removed. So this is the new number which we have. Then again, what I will do, I will do modulus 10. After doing modulus 10, what answer I will get is 4. Now, to add it to 4 here, okay, to add 4 to the next position, what I have to do is, I have to multiply 1 with 10, then add 4, then I will get 14, right? If I have to add it to the number which I have here, in the second position, what I have to do is, I have to multiply it with 10 and add the number which I have to add. So, I will get 14 here, okay? So, I got 14 as new number. What's my next step? I will divide by 10. So when I divide by 10, I'll get as the new number as 14525, and then I'll do modulus 10. When I do modulus 10, I'll get the remainder as 5. I'll multiply this by 10 and add 5. Okay, so what I'll get is 145. Then again I will do divided by 10. So what answer I'll get is 1452. Then I will do modulus 10. When I do modulus 10, I'll get 2. I'll multiply this number with 10 and add 2, so I'll get here 1452. In the same way, I'll keep on doing the division and the modulus operation. So what I'll get is the finally 5 will be coming 5 4 and 1. So 5 4 1 will come here. So this is the number which I want, 1 4 5 2 5 4 1. So I'll be comparing with this one. This is the initial number which I have not edited, so I took a copy here. Okay. So this original number will be compared with the number which I got here. If it's same, it's a palindrome, else it's not a palindrome. Now let's look at what are the steps we need to follow to approach this solution. First, we need to create, we need to input the number, okay? This is a number which are taken from the user. Our second step is to store the number in a copy, okay? Store the number in a copy, okay? After that, what we are doing is, we are doing basically three steps. First, we are storing r is equal to the remainder, right? R is equal to the remainder, which is n1 modulus 10. This I am storing in r, only for the first case. For the first case, I am not multiplying by anything, okay? Or else we can take like this also. First, r will be 0, okay? R will be 0, 0 multiplied by 10 plus is equal to. So what is 0 multiplied by 10? 0 plus is equal to n1 modulus 10. n1 modulus 10 initially will give me 1 here because this is the last digit. So what I will get is 1. Okay. Then in the next iteration, I have the number r updated as 1. So then in the next iteration, 1 will be multiplied with 10 and added the remainder. Before that, we have to perform one step, which is n1 divide is equal to 10. So that the last digit will be erased. So the number will be this much. Repeating these steps till the end, until n the copy which number which I have that becomes 0, we have to do these steps. After that, r will be compared with the original number n. Okay, so let's write the program here. So our first step is to take the number. Okay, so let's take the number from the user. So here let's write int n, which is the number which I have to take, and n1 is the copy of it. So first we will be taking the number from the user. Let's create a scanner object. N is equal to sc dot next int. We have taken the input from the user. This same input will be copied to n1 also. Okay, so here we have n1 is equal to n. Okay, after getting the copy of the number, what we are supposed to do is we have to run a while loop, right? We have to run a while loop while n1 is not equal to 0. While n1 is not equal to 0, what we have to do is 3 steps. The first step is r plus is equal to n modulus 10, right? N modulus 10. Then we have to do n divide is equal to 10, right? And we'll initialize r as 0 first. R is equal to 0, and it's not just r into 10. Okay, so after doing that, what we'll get is r into 10 is showing an error here. So basically we can't do the operation of r into 10 with the same operation as initializing the value. So first we will multiply r with 10 in the upper line, then we will add it. Okay, r is equal to r into 10. Okay, so this will work. And after this line, what we will do is n divide is equal to 10, it will n1 divide is equal to 10, and here also n1. Okay, so until n1 reaches 0, we will be adding on the value till r. And after this loop gets over, we will be comparing r with, if r equal to n, which is the original number and the result which we got. If it's same, we have to print out its palindrome. Else what we have to print out, it's not a palindrome. Okay, so we'll write else. So I'll be taking the same example which I have taken here, 1452541. Okay, 1452541. Okay, so it's showing it's a palindrome. Let's try for another number which is not a palindrome, like 1234. This is not a palindrome. It should show me not palindrome. Okay, so it's showing me not a palindrome. Okay, so this was the palindrome question. Let's move on to the next one, which is this is about convert the programs in the three of these things into functions. So it's pretty simple, because whatever functions I have written in the main, I'll be separating and writing in the functions part. Okay, so we'll not do this one for now, and we'll be moving on with the 12th, which is write a function to check if a given triplet is a Pythagorean triplet or not. Okay, so a Pythagorean triplet is when the sum of the squares of two numbers is equal to the square of the third number. Okay, so what does that mean? Suppose that I have the two numbers as 3 and 4, okay? I have the two numbers 3 and 4, okay? And the third number is 5, okay? So what is 3 square? 3 square is 9, 4 square is 16, 9 plus 16 is 25. So the squares of the first two numbers equals to the square of the third number. So this is a Pythagorean triplet, okay? So given an array, we have been given with an array of many numbers. Okay, there will be many elements in it. We have to find out if there is any combination of three elements whose squares are like in a Pythagorean triplet. Okay, so that is our task. How can we approach this question? Okay, in the website I'll be seeing from the website here. So in this website, what is given is that initial array is given as this one, 3, 1, 4, 6, and 5. Okay, this is the initial array.
First, what we'll be doing is we'll be squaring each element, okay? 3 square 9, 1 square 1, 4 square 16, 6 square 36, 5 square 25. After we have the squared array here, what we'll be doing, we'll be sorting it 1, 9, 16, 25 and 36, okay? After sorting, our first step is we'll initialize three pointers. The first, L will be pointing to the 0th location and I will be pointing to the last location, okay? And R will be always I minus 1 initially, okay? What we'll be checking here is we'll be adding up this 1 plus 25. What is 1 plus 25? 26. And that 20, and the sum is less than 36 or more than 36. 26 is less than 36, right? So what we have to do is we have to increment this value because we need to approach 36, right? So L will become 9 now. L will be pointing to 9 now, and we'll be doing 9 plus 25. 9 plus 25 is 24. So still we'll increment this one. It will come here. 16 plus 25 is greater than 36, incrementing R. So here two things we are doing. Whenever the sum which L and R are pointing to, if the sum is less than 36, we will increment L, else will decrement R, okay? Else will decrement R, okay? So in that way, we will be keep on checking, and one point will reach when 16 and 25 are greater, means the sum is greater than 36, so we have to decrement R. R will be now pointing to 16. When both of these are pointing to 16, our first iteration gets over. Okay, if this L and R both are pointing to 16, that means we have to decrement the I value. Okay, because for 36 we could not find any combination equal to 36. So what we'll be doing is we'll be decrementing I. Then we'll be checking for 25. Is there any sum which will be equal to 25 or not? That we'll be checking. Okay, so I will become 25 here. So I is pointing to 25 now. Then we'll restart L from here and R will be here because we need to find the sum among these three elements. 1 plus 16 less than 25, increment this one. 9 plus 16 is equal to 25. Therefore, we'll print out that 25 is the sum. Okay, means Pythagorean triplet is there. 9, 16 and 25, which is nothing but the elements 3, 4 and 5. These are the elements 3, 4 and 5 which form the Pythagorean triplet. Okay, there are many other ways you can check in this website. Okay, so for now I'll be going on with this implementation. So what are the steps here? The first step is the taking the array, okay, initial array. Let's do one by one and return back to this website. So first, our first step is to take an array here. So I'll be writing int arr is equal to, let's take the same elements, which were the elements here. In the example given, the elements were 3, 1, 4, 6, 5. Okay, so we'll be writing here 3, 1, 4, 6 and 5. So these are the elements which we have in the array, and after taking the array, what is our next step? Our next step is to store the square of each element. To find out the square of each element, what we can do is we can run a for loop which will be running from 1 to 5, and each time what it will be storing is arr of I is equal to arr of I into arr of I. So it will be squaring the value of the array of I, and that will be stored in array of I. So after this point, we will be having an array which will be the squared array. Okay, so this array we have now, and our next step is to sort the array. For sorting, I'll be using the inbuilt function, which is arrays.sort arr. Okay, so this will sort the array in the increasing order. Okay, so we have a sorted array now. What is our next step? Our next step is to initialize three pointers. L to 0 means 0th location, I to the n minus 1 location means the total size minus 1, there it will be pointing I, and R will be I minus 1. So let's initialize that. We'll be creating three pointers here, L, R and I, and L will be equal to 0, the first index, and I will be equal to arr dot size minus 1. Okay, so array's size will be returned here, and that will be done with minus 1. Sorry, it's not size, it's length. So here we'll be using length, and I guess we have to use length like this. So we'll get the array length minus 1, that is that location will be pointed by I, and R will be equal to I minus 1. Okay, so we have initialized three pointers here, with the first pointer here, second I here and R here. After pointing this, what we have to do is we have to do some checks. Okay, first check what we'll do. First check we'll do is array of L plus array of I equal to array of is array of L plus array of R equal to array of I or not? Means 1 plus 25 is equal to 36 or not? That we'll be checking. Okay.
and we'll be doing this in a while loop. While I is greater than 1. What is I is greater than 1 mean? See here. I is pointing to here. When it comes here, when it comes to here at this point, if I is here, suppose, then L will be here and R will be I minus 1. So R and L both will be pointing to here when I is 1, right? At that time, that's not the solution, because at least two elements should be there here, but only one element will be there here when I will come here. When I will come to 1, first index, only one location is there. That is not possible. Okay, means sum is not possible. So at that time, we'll break out of the loop. Okay, so until I is greater than 1 means at least I should be here, means 2. So that two locations will be empty for checking if the sum is possible or not. So this while loop's breaking condition is that I is greater than 1. Okay, and here we'll have a boolean to know if boolean's value has changed, and based on that we will output if the Pythagorean triplet is possible or not. Okay, so inside the while loop, what we have to do, first we have to check if array of L plus array of R is equal to array of I. If it's equal, at that time what we have to do is B is equal to true. Okay, this the boolean value of B will become true, since we have found a Pythagorean triplet because of this condition. And what we'll do is we'll break out of the while loop. Else, if it's not the case, then what can be the case? The next case is that array of L plus array of R is less than array of I. If it's less than array of I, what had we discussed before? If it's less than that, we'll do L plus plus. That means if the sum is less, that means L value should increment, right? So L will be pointing to this location. That can be achieved by writing L plus plus. If that's not the case, else what we'll be doing is R minus minus. Means the sum is greater. What you have to do is you have to find a smaller sum. So we'll decrement the R value. Okay. So we have written here R minus minus. And after this check here, what check you have to do is if R equal to L. If both point to the same location, we have to do three things. L is equal to 0, L will start from 0. See here. If both are pointing to the same location, L will be starting from here and R will be here only, means I will decrement. Okay, I will become here. Okay. So let's make that change. L is equal to 0, I minus minus, I will come one position to the left, and lastly R is equal to I minus 1. Okay. Initially when we are starting, R will be 1 less than the I. Okay. So after doing this, what we'll be doing is we'll be finally checking after the while loop. Okay, this where the while loop ends, and after the while loop ends, what we'll be checking is if B is equal to true. Okay. If B is true, we'll be outputting its possible Pythagorean triplet, else it's not. Okay. So I've written the two cases here. If it's B is true, it's possible. Else, had we not got any value which is equal, B would have not become true, and B will be false only. And so we'll be outputting it's not possible. Let's run the program and see. After we run the program for 31465, we'll get Pythagorean triplet is possible. And when we change the values, it's showing it's not possible. Okay. Our next question is to write a function that returns all prime numbers between the given two numbers. Okay. For this, from the int main, what we'll be doing is we'll be taking the value. Okay, int n is equal to sc dot next int. So we'll get the number till which we want to find if there are any numbers less than that which are prime or not. Here, write a function that returns all prime numbers between the given two numbers. Okay, so two numbers we have to input. So this is the first number, the second number is n2. Okay, let it be n2. N2 is equal to sc dot next n. Okay, so we got the two numbers here, let it be n1. So between two numbers, you have to find out how many are prime numbers or not. Okay, so for that, what we'll be doing is we'll be calling the function prime or not. This is the function it will be defining now, and here we'll be passing n1 and n2. Okay. And the function says that it returns. Returns means we can create an array, I guess, to return all the numbers between n1 and n2. But I'm not sure how to return an array. So what I'll be doing is I'll be just printing the values. Okay. So for returning the values, we'll see later on how to do that. But for now, I'll be returning the values. Okay. So if the function does not return any value, we'll just print the values. Okay. So here we have n1 and n2. Now let's define the function, which is time not, time or not. Okay. So I've written the function definition here, which is void prime or not. So in this function, we'll be printing the values, which are prime numbers between n1 and n2. Okay. So let's now think how to approach this question. Okay. So suppose that the numbers given are 5 and 15. How can we find out the prime numbers between 5 and 15? For each, what we'll be doing? Between 5 and 15, what we have to do is we have to run a for loop which runs from 5 to 15, and in that, what we'll be doing is we'll have another for loop inside it, which will be checking if the number is a prime or not. Okay, to check if a number is a prime or not. Okay, to check if a number is a prime or not, what we'll be doing is we'll be dividing that number from 0, from 1, okay, from 1 to that number. Suppose that first we are checking for 5, so we'll be dividing the number, means 5 modulus j. Okay, if it's equal to 0, break and return, means if it's not a prime number. If for all the values of j from 1 to 5 it's not divisible except for 5, at that case we'll return it's a prime number, and when we return it's a prime number, it will print it's a prime number. Then we'll do the same for the 6. Okay, means suppose for 6, what will be the case? I will be running from 1 to not 6, 5. So I'll be running from 1 to 5 in case of 6, because 6 can't be considered. So here also, not 1, sorry, it will be running from 2 to 5. And what are we checking? 6 modulus 2 equal to 0, then 6 modulus 3 equal to 0, then 6 modulus 4, then 6 modulus 5. If any of the case, if it becomes 0, it's not a prime number. Else, it's a prime number. Whenever it's a prime number, we'll return that it's a prime number, and there we'll output that number. Okay. So initially, what we'll do? We'll run a for loop between 5 and 15. So let's do that. Here we have to run the for loop again. For in I is equal to n1, okay, I is less than or equal to n2, and I plus plus. So it will be running from n1 to n2. In each case, what you have to do is for int j is equal to 2, from 2 to n1 we will run, okay, and j plus plus. If at any case, right, if n1 modulus 2, n1 modulus 2, not n1, sorry, it's I, okay, because we are taking the value of n1 as I, and that will be incrementing. So I percentage 2, I modulus 2, if I modulus not 2, j, if I modulus j equal to 0, at that time we have to return false. We can't return false, but what we can do is we can have a flag, okay, like bool. Okay, so we'll create a bool here. So boolean b is equal to, let's let it be boolean b, okay, and each time what will be the case is boolean means b will be true. Okay, b will be true initially for each iteration, and if it's equal to 0, b will become false. Okay, b will become false, and after this iteration gets over, we'll be checking the value of b. If b equal to true, at that time print the number. What is the number? That is I. Okay, I and a space. So whenever b is true, that means if it not become false, that means it's a prime number, we'll output that number here. Okay, and if it's become false, we'll not do anything. Okay, so here we have to enter two numbers. Let's enter 5 and 15. So between 5 and 15, what are the prime numbers? 5 is a prime number, 7, 11 and 13. Okay, so it gives me the correct output, and this is the code for the if it's a prime number or not, the this question. Okay, if it's a prime number or not, this write a function that returns the sum of first n natural numbers. Okay, so let's do this one. So here what all changes we need to make? We just need to have one integer, which is the number till which number we have to find out the sum, and the question and the function name is that sum of n numbers. Okay, So sum of n numbers is the function name, and here we will be passing n, which will be taken from the user, and let's define this function. Here it will be accepting one integer, which is n, and here we have to do the formula. The formula for calculating the sum of first n numbers is let's create int sum is equal to n into n plus 1 divided by 2. This is the formula for calculating the sum of first n numbers, and we'll be returning this value. So let's try to run this program. This will be returned here, so we have to store it in some way, like sum. It will be stored in sum, and then we'll be printing the sum value. So it's the same name. So let's keep that s here. So it will be returning a value which is the sum, and it should be public static int, because it's returning an int value. And here we will be outputting the sum. Okay, which is s. So let's try to run this program. Here we have to input our value n till which integer we want to find out the sum. So as of now, I know that the sum of first n the sum of first n integers is 55. Okay, so let's try that. Let's give 55. Okay. So this is all about the functions program, the functions video. I'll put the link of the source codes of the problems in the description. And thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.